हेलो हाय एवरीवन, वेलकम टू दी वेबिनार ऑन कन्वर्जेशनल एंड कॉन्टेक्चुअल एआई। आई एम रोहित जगाती, एवीपी इंजीनियरिंग, नॉर्डस इनकॉर्पोरेशन। आई हैव एक्सटेंसिव एक्सपीरियंस इन मैनेजिंग प्रोजेक्ट्स, प्रोग्राम्स, डिजाइनिंग सॉल्यूशंस, कस्टम सॉल्यूशंस ऑन आईओटी, ब्लॉकचेन एंड एंटरप्राइज एप्लीकेशन इंटीग्रेशन। And I have deep interest in artificial intelligence, especially on the conversational and contextual AI, and we'll be talking on it in this webinar. So our agenda of this webinar is, we'll let you know on a brief on the Nordis, then we'll cover what exactly is conversational and contextual AI, why we call it contextual, a high level idea of how conversational AI works, the conversational AI main components. We'll be covering some fundamentals of natural language processing, which is basically the core of the conversational and contextual AI. We'll go through some standards and best practices. We'll cover some use cases for the conversational and contextual AI, and then just we'll have some kind of hands-on or a live demonstration of how exactly it works based on the RASA framework. About Nordis. So Nordis is a technology consulting firm with a strong focus on the modernizing the digital systems at the pace of your business demands. We are into functional, reactive, cloud native areas. We have quite strong competencies around the Internet of Things, Internet of Vehicles, microservices, APIs, strong AI and data engineering practices, and DevOps practices. Some of the partnerships that we have, Lightband, we have Confluent, DataStax, APG, HashiCorp, IBM, and Databricks. So what exactly is conversational and contextual AI? So conversational artificial intelligence, it generally refers to technologies that we talk about, like digital assistants, chatbots, virtual agents, question and answering systems, which cover both the AI-based question and answering systems or rule-based. Rule-based are kind of systems where the conversation or the way the flow works is fixed based on some conditions and with which the users can talk to. So this was basically used earlier, but in some of the conversational, there are some elements of rule-based that are still used. Conversational AI uses large volumes of data. So if I talk about large volumes of data, it's basically the data on which the AI is trained on. Conversational AI is based on machine learning, natural language processing. So there are these elements of machine learning, natural language understanding, natural language processing, and natural language generation. And it helps in imitating human interactions, like recognizing speech and text inputs and translating their meanings across various languages. So the core of conversational contextual AI are deep learning models, natural language understanding, processing, and it revolves around these. So if I talk about contextual AI basically is talking in context to a specific topic, just like we human beings converse. So it understands what topic is being discussed, and the responses that it generates are from the one based on that context only. So this is how the contextual AI piece works. So it's just not conversing anything. It understands the context, responds in context to that. So there are some elements of AI and natural language processing that play here, and which basically understands the context, and responses are specific to that context. So the conversation doesn't deviate from those contexts. So this is how the contextual thing comes into picture, and we'll be just discussing this in some more detail in the subsequent slides. Now, how conversational AI works. So conversational AI uses a combination of natural language processing, machine learning, speech recognition, understanding of language, the natural language understanding, the natural language generation, other language technologies to process and contextualize the spoken or written words, and as well as figure out the best way to handle and the best responses based on the learning that the model have been trained on in the form of natural language generation. So if we see this diagram below, so in this diagram below, there are two, a user asks a specific question. So we are just talking in terms of general how the conversational AI works. So if we see, there is one green box, which is language understanding, and the next one is the dialogue management box. So these two are basically the core components of the conversational AI. Now how it works, if you see the red boxes, speech to text and text to piece, I've just kind of made it in a different frame just to make it clear that this could be a part of the thing. So if we talk about a voice based assistance, the voice part, the voice interface is also taken to place, and it's part of the understanding pipeline where a user voice is interpreted, converted into text, then that is fed into the understanding and the NLP models, and then again to the dialogue management models, and then if it's a voice based interface, again that text is converted to the respective speech for that particular language, and then it's transmitted back to the user. Now going back to this diagram again, so user asks a specific question, which could be a voice based or text. The natural language understanding model, the NLP model, which is the first interface, it basically interprets those messages. It passes, breaks down into, there are some elements of natural language processing understanding that takes place here. It passes that data to the dialogue management model, which basically has that capability and the learning that has been provided to make the next best response to that particular understanding, which it has already learned from the training that has been provided, and then it responds back to the user. So this is how the conversational AI works. This is a high level. So there are different elements in both the models, the language understanding model, the dialogue management model that takes place here. Again, if we talk about languages, we have different languages that are there. So we have to have specific kind of libraries and models which basically enable or facilitate in understanding the language specific models. Going to the next slide, the conversational and AI main components. So in continuation with the understanding that we just built on the AI, conversational AI, how exactly it works. Now going down to the, or breaking it down into a more deeper level, how exactly both these parts work. So first one is the NLU, so where we said the understanding model and the dialogue management. So these two are two separate AI models that basically help in the forming of those contexts that we were talking about earlier. Now, if the NLU model now is like again broken down into intent classification and entity extraction. So we'll go through this in more detail once we do the exercise where we'll be creating a small pot, which will have all these elements. And the dialogue management model again is another component of AI, which basically gets data from the NLU model and then processes it and then generates the output and the action type. So if we talk about the NLU model, we see that there are two parts here, the intent classification and the entity extraction. So intent here is basically what the user intent. Instance, so let's say I as a user say hi or hello or hey there. So these are intents, and these intents can be classified into, let's say, greetings. So greetings, the intent greeting will have different ways of greetings. Let's say I say hi. So all these different ways of greeting mean the same thing. That is, it's a greeting, and it is basically again broken. Can be broken down into hi, hey, hey there, hello, right? So these are all. So this is how the learning of the NLU model takes place. We categorize different types of intents and then train the model. So it understands if it's a greeting or if it's a search. Let's say for a search intent, I'm looking for a place to have dinner. So this intent could be a search for a particular restaurant or thing, right? So this is how the intent classification works. It interprets the what the user is asking, categorizes or classifies it into intents, and based on that intent, it passes to you. Next one is the entity. So entities could be anything like a name, it could be a place, or it could be a. So there are libraries available to already extract entities from given sentences. So those libraries facilitate in extracting intent and understanding the context. Let's say I want to understand whether the user is looking for a specific place. So I can extract that entity. When I train the NLU model, I can say, okay, if this is the sentence, this is the entity. So these libraries extract those entities. So they already named entity recognition libraries that are available, especially SPACY, which has quite vast capabilities, especially around the English language, which helps you extract those entities from these sentences. Now, once the intent classification and entity extraction is done, that is the way that data is prepared for the dialogue management models to work. Now, what exactly it does behind is, so these basically create a kind of a feature vector, which basically is more on the technical terms. It creates a feature vector and passes to the dialogue management model. Now, how the dialogue management model works, we again have to train the dialogue management model. Dialogue management model is how the assistant should respond to specific questions or the input from the NLU. So we again have to provide training. So we don't have to provide exact training of if the response is this, then you. So there are certain kind of practices around which we have to provide training to the dialogue management model, which basically helps it in generating the output. So if I say user says hello, so I have to train the model. Okay, if the user's intent is greetings, I should say okay, he says hello, the bot should respond, or the assistant should respond with hello, how are you, and it could also be, and can I know your name. So those kind of trainings or the data sets are provided to the dialogue management when the dialogue management model is being trained, and then it understands. So next time anything similar to that is provided to the dialogue management model, it basically understands the languages or the thing that are passed to it, and then interprets it and provides the best response to it. So here a lot of different things are used, especially on the NLU side, the natural language processing side, where we have these elements of natural language processing that take facilitate, which basically are tokenization. It basically breaks sentences into tokens. The natural language, the natural or the named entity recognition part takes takes its part to extract the entities. We have stemming lemmatization, which basically enables to extract features out of these. Now feature, once the feature vectors for the NLU model are created, this again feature vector is passed to the dialog management model. So the dialog management model has, so the architecture of this, the dialog management model is such that it retains the, so how it understands the context is, it has the context of the earlier conversation that the user has taken place. So if it's the first time, there won't be anything, but if it's the first time, so it will retain that conversation or the context of that conversation. And when the user again responds or asks something, it will use that context as well to make the match. So it will take the previous state of the conversation as well as the current state, and basis that it will decide what the output should be. So this is how it varies from the AI part basically takes place. So this is the difference, or this is what we say, it's a contextual way. So it has the earlier state of the conversation as well and the current, and basis that data, once it is fed to the dialog management model, it decides what should be the output, and then it predicts the output. And if we see the action types, so action type again, it could be a simple response back to the user, or it could be a API call. API call is a kind of backend integration. So the best part of these the conversational AI platforms is that you can integrate backend platforms as well. Let's say I am it's a HR assistant, and a user asks for his leave balances. So it goes to the NLU model, it goes to the dialog management model, and then once the output of the dialog management model is generated, it can decide whether it needs to call some other application, some other integration. So this is how the API call feature is used here. It can call backend, and once the that output from that call is generated, or the system gets the response back from the backend, it again can feed it back to the model, or it can just generate the output to the user in a natural language. It again, it could be a text-based response, or it could be if it's a voice-based, again there will be an element in the pipeline where the text is converted to voice. So this is how the main components of AI, conversational AI work. Going to the next one, there are some fundamentals of NLP and NLU, which are basically the core of any conversation. So since it's a language thing, these elements of NLP and NLU are core to building the conversational and contextual AI framework. So we start with tokenization. Tokenization is basically breaking down into smaller semantic units. Let's say there's a sentence, we break it down into words, parts of speech, tagging up, POS tagging, like it can extract nouns, verbs, adjectives from a sentence, stemming and lemmatization. So these are basically again reducing words to their forms. Let's say if it is running or it's standing, so running could be converted into run. So this is how it breaks. It doesn't need that part. It only extracts those parts. So these are again part of the natural language understanding pipeline. So whatever things we need to use as part of the pipeline, we use. So there are standard libraries around it which basically facilitate this. Stop word removal, again filtering out common words that doesn't add much to the information. Okay, dependency parsers are there, which basically analyzing the structure of a grammatical structure of a sentence and based on the dependencies. So all these are as part of the natural language processing. There are libraries around it which basically helps in extracting these from and these basically enable in generating the feature vector. Going to the next slide. Now, standards and best practices. So if you talk about conversational AI standards and best practices, so since this is again kind of a part of an AI ML kind of a cycle, so the best practices that would again apply here are most that are related to the project management practices. So if we use the agile approach, so it's basically building iteratively and incrementally. Let's say I need to build a conversational AI for an organization. The best practice would be decide on the scope, plan an MVP, and start iterating it and incrementally. So once the MVP is realized, review it, go through it, what the things work not, and then have that incrementally planned into the subsequent sprint. So it's basically a way of executing the project. So short-term goals and with the long-term roadmap and seeing where we things are working. So that's one of the practice. So this is basically the way to develop or the project management program management practice. So next one is if the conversation has to be on a specific domain, let's say I want to build a conversational assistant for a legal domain or for a medical kind of a domain or medical diagnostics kind of, so we have to use specific domain kind of knowledge there. So it is basically proposed that or it's recommended that we should use the help of domain experts to create the that kind of data, which both the natural language understanding model and the dialogue management model both basically for both these models, for the natural language understanding model and as well as for the dialogue management. So both the help of domain experts, because the way language understanding works is normally they are pre-trained models which basically are just trained on some specific general English language, right? And if there are some domain specific things like medical terms, it might not understand those kind of words. So to make that kind of learning into those models, we need to have capabilities in our model to understand those specific terms in that specific domain. So here the expertise of domain subject matter experts come into play. Next one is the right set and number of intents. So I'll be going through this the intents that me what I what is meant in once we go through the exercise of building a simple model. So it's like we have to, it's again part of the AI where we need to have good quality and quantity of data for the models to be trained on. So for both the natural language understanding and for the dialogue management. So this is basically is covered from there. And if I have to create a conversational assistant, then it is a best practice to start testing it early and testing it continuously in the life cycle. So that is one of the best way to evolve and build a very a stable model, if possible use. So interactive learning is like giving the conversational assistant to some users and seeing how it responds and then tweaking it or changing it interactively and then again training it. So this is one form which has quite evolved and the practice is being followed. So that is another standards around the conversational assistant. Test with actual users. So if we say test with actual users, so normally what happens is we generally do the development, developers do the kind of some kind of tests, just go through it, then there are some QA. But for conversational AIs to be successful, it is always a good thing to have some actual users who would be using the system. It could not be end to end, but actually the way conversation takes place between a user and a digital assistant varies from user to user. So the best practice is to have some kind of program where once the MVP or before the MVP, we can kind of release it for kind of pre-release it for the end users to go through it. And the best part here is, so once those users interact with the system, we get that data, training data, and we can again train and test and validate the model using this. So it's always a best practice to test with. Otherwise, it might happen that we have done the development and testing ourselves, and then when we release it to the actual users, there are a lot of variations and it doesn't respond as expected. So one of the things or practice to be noticed is to test with actual users. Always have a fallback. So fallback policies are part of the dialogue management. So if the bot is not able to understand a context, so there are certain policies that are applied, whether how many times the user should ask the questions, or if the user bot is not able to understand the context, so how it should be interpreted, what should be the fallback policy. Fallback policies are like, if a bot is not able to understand the context, it should fall back to a story where it says, okay, can you repeat it? Or if it still doesn't understand it, it could be a human transfer. So we have these capabilities in the assistance where if you want, you can do a human transfer. So if the bot doesn't understand, or if it reaches such a state that the bot, it's difficult for the bot, or it's not actually practical for the bot, we basically use the human transfer, where it transfers to an actual human being who can then continue with the conversation that is having. So the for NLP, I think since the basic or the initial part is quite critical to building conversational assistants, the right set of libraries need to be used for the NLP, where it does the tokenization, stemming, lemmatization, those kind of things. And it also varies from language. So SPACY is quite widely known. There are other libraries as well, NLTK, LNNLP. So there are quite a variety of them available. But again, these are good for English, but for specific languages like German, like French, they are, those things need to be considered, which libraries are there, because again, languages vary in the way the sentences are formed. Languages, their words, basically two words also mean a single word. So those kind of understanding or extracting those kind of things from those languages can only be done using these specific libraries. Going to the next, so use cases are quite varied for conversational and contextual AI. It can be a simple customer service help desk, where user can request for their some kind of services, help, virtual HR automation. We can have virtual assistants working for automating the HR department, where any particular query, instead of for employee going to the HR for some kind of information, we can set up virtual HRs where they can talk to a bot, extract the policies and answer it. So it could be a combination of kind of a simple assistant along with some kind of question and answering system. So those things are quite getting popular these days, question answering system. Then personal assistance could be, let's say I want to have a personal assistant and I want it to remind me of certain things. So I can have that kind of thing incorporated into my portal, and then if I want to get any details from my personal assistant, I can help ask him to remind me of certain things, add certain things to certain portfolios. So those kind of things. Medical, I think this medical side and the legal side are getting quite popular, where at least the initial level of diagnosis and the initial level of legal consulting you can do with bots. And then once you reach at a certain stage, then you can go for further consultations or those kind of things. Autonomous organization is another way where we have bots or assistants fulfilling the needs of various departments. So if I want to automate my organization, I can have kind of bots for every department which basically converse among them. So this is kind of more in the development and evolving phase. So might be that going forward we see those kind of organizations where everything's automated. We'll go to a demonstration of showcasing the concepts of conversation and contextual AI using Raza. So as I said earlier, we'll be going through or we'll be using the Raza conversational AI framework. So Raza is basically one of the leading conversational and contextual AI frameworks, and it's quite popular. It's open source. There are proprietary ones as well, which are licensed ones, which are more scalable. But the open source is also quite useful and capable. So it's like the basic prerequisites for running it are Python is I think the only thing that is needed for initiating or creating a Raza bot. So I have created a virtual environment, and my Python is already installed here. So I just have to go to a folder here and say Raza in it. So it is basically like cloning from the Raza repository here, and it will basically download all the files that are needed to start a simple bot. So if it says enter a path, so if I don't enter a path, it will create the bot in my current present directory. I just click enter. So it is asking me whether I want to train an initial bot. So training is like, we'll go through this in detail, and I'll say yes. So it will download all the data, and it will train the initial model. I have said yes, and it has started training an initial model as well as download. So this is just a basic model that is there. So it's normal, any AI thing. So all the pipelines, the way it works, are already built into the thing. So this is basically the default that it would provide. So if you see, it's showing NLU model training completed. So there are two models. One is the natural language understanding model. Now, next one is the dialogue management model. So now it's again training. We'll just go and see it in more detail once this is done. Now the core model. So dialogue management model is called Raza Core here. So it has so it wants me to say, do you want to speak to the train? So I will say no here. So it has what it has done with that is it has downloaded all the relevant files that are needed. It has trained both the models, NLU, and so how the training has happened is training, there are some default data that it uses to train the initial model. So if I open, so this is how I'm just opening it in Visual Studio Code. So this is basically the structure of this conversational platform that I just downloaded and initiated. And if I go to this, so here we see the NLU and the so I'll just open this. So this is what the training data looks like. If you see, there is an intent. So again, if we have to like use it, there are certain kind of practices for using or making changes in the file. So it should be similar. So it has already created a boilerplate code where you see the NLU part. So this already has intents greet. So if I say greet, it could mean any of these things. Hey, hello, hi. So this is the data set that is provided by default. Intent goodbye is again any of these words would mean goodbye, right? So this is how the language model all the similar kind of words which basically mean the same thing are categorized or classified into an intent, similar to any AI model. Like even if it's a vision model, when we categorize, let's say for a computer vision, let's say cat, so all the pictures of cat would belong to a class cat. So same way here, all the similar words meaning the same thing would again be classified into intent. So this is basically the first one, and again this is the way it has to be structured in Raya. So I'm just talking in terms of Raza. This could also be developed or custom developed using your own pipeline. So you can create your classification models, you can use Spacy and other libraries to do the same thing, where you have first create that data set for classifying intents. Then again you have to, so it would be a bigger thing when you do it from scratch. You might have to do everything from here. The framework and pipeline already provides a lot of capabilities where you can just start using it. So this is my NLU model, which is basically the initial part where it understands the language. Now if I go to the stories are the part of the Raza core, or the dialogue management model, which basically understands from the NLU and then creates the next best action. So if we say story path, so this is how the learning of the core or the dialogue management part takes place. You have to define some stories here, like let's say if the intent is greet, action should be utter greet. So we'll go to this part as well, so utter greet. And if the next intent is okay, great, this is how we should reply to it, right? So this is, these are basically the kind of training data that we feed to the dialogue management model, and it understands. We don't have to feed the exact one, only basic or more kind of quality things that we think a user could do, and the rest of the thing it learns itself. So that is basically the best part of it. We don't have to provide exactly everything here, that okay, if user says this, then again the element of AI would not be there. So the element of AI is again, it learns from here. If the context is similar, then it understands the intent and again creates the action based on it. So this is how the dialogue management model works. And if I go to the so this is the data part. Again, when we just downloaded it, it said initially, do you want to train? So that training was done, and it stores the trained model in this folder here. There is an action. So we were talking about the actions. So if I want to integrate anything from my backend, let's say if I want to integrate my human capital management application with my bot, and I want to extract an employee's leaves from that database, I can use the action. So action is basically a kind of Python program, and you have to call the endpoints from here, and it will basically get data from get response from that endpoint, get it here. If you want to feed it into the models, you can do it. Otherwise you can just provide responses from here. So this is basically the action part. There are a lot of things that can be done, so I'm just telling you the basic here, that this is basically used for that. If we go to here, if you go to this folder configuration, so these are basically the pipelines that are set. So this is by default the pipeline that are provided by Raza. So it depends on us which pipeline we are using, what policies we are using. So this again is a kind of a bigger topic in itself. We can cover in some other webinar. So this is just basically, as I talked about, the natural language processing side, the tokenizer is there, the feature vectorizers are there, the classifiers are there, and normally more on the AI side, what kind of epochs we are using, what how much the trainings are using. Again, this is for the dialogue management model, where we use what kind of policies we are using, and it decides from these policies, based on the predictions by these policies, which what should be the next best action. This file, the domain.xml file, is quite critical. Here we again have to define all the intents, whatever, not exactly the details of the intent, but what intents we are using. So when it builds the model, it basically validates from here. So if there is something discrepancy, it will let you know. Again, we were talking about those utter greeds in this file there, data. So when we talk about the stories, the dialog model, so it says utter greed, right? So this is again would be present here. So for all the responses are here. So utter greed, this is, if it's a greed, you have to say this thing. So these things are generally built here, and you don't have to put everything here. It understands from the context and decides on what should be there. So it depends on the your quantity and quality of data as well, and the similarity in those intents. So if totally depends on the data set that are provided for training the NLU and the dialog management model. We'll just see a working of it. So to run a model from command prompt, you just have to say Raza shell. It will load the model. So Raza shell is basically just creating that kind of interface where we can test your model. So it's starting my model. Okay, so now it has loaded the model, and I can start experimenting with it. Let's say we have had these kind of intents, right? Greet. So let's see what it says when I say hi here. I will say hi, right? So this is again part of the intent. So when we saw the intents here, so this is intent greet. So I'll also show you how it is classifying this after this, the intents. And if you talk about the stories, if the intent is greet, it says utter greet, right? So if it is, I will see what the utter greet says. Hey, how are you? So if we say, it has uttered me, hey, how are you? So this is how basically the conversation. So if I say, I am good. So this is a conversation path that has been predicted by the bot. Now again, I'll show you another one. Hi. If I say not good. Okay, so it has responded me. So here you see that everything is coming on the console itself. But if we want to have this kind of integrated with a web application or a mobile application, we again have to build a small user interface, which basically will facilitate in interacting with the bot. So it says, here is something you can, so if I copy this from here and post it here, so it has sent me. So if I said I'm not good, it has responded me, okay, you please cheer up, this is just to refresh your mood and that. So this is how basically it works. Now I was talking to you about the I'll just load it again. I just wanted to show you one more thing here. So we were talking about the intent classification, how the bot classifies the intent. So there's another way of seeing it, how the classification is working here for the NLU model. This is not for the dialogue management part, this is for the initial part. So it will again, sorry, I have to cancel it. I have to load the Raza shell. So the command is different here. So shell is basically for interacting with the bot, and if I just want to run the NLU model, so it will, I'll say Rasa shell NLU, so it will load only the NLU model. Okay, it has loaded. So if I say hi, okay, so hi is basically an intent greet, right? So it is exact match, but I'll show you how it works. So if I say hi, so if you see here, it's a normal AI model. It's not saying that it should be this. It is just predicting that, okay, the confidence level of this intent hi is class called greet. So it is matching greet that. It and the other intent it has matched are quite low in confidence, right? So the mood unhappy, it's not matching. So this is basically what the NLU model does. So it's basically, if you want to test your NLU side, you can use the shell part and see how it is responding or how it is understanding the intents. So this was the demonstration. Hope you are able to understand the concepts and the working of a conversational and contextual AI. And thank you everyone, and have a good day. Thanks.